family, and Hampshire music culture from 1770 to 1820. I have studied the 17 music books owned by the Austens and various archival sources to construct a picture of domestic and public music making in Hampshire. The music books are a combination of printed and manuscript music. The latter has been carefully copied out by hand. 8 of the books belong to the Jane Austen Memorial Trust and are housed at Chawton Cottage and the Hampshire Record Office. 7 books belong to Richard Jenkins, which are on loan at Chawton House, the 18th century resource centre. And I recently discovered 2 belong to Richard Knight, which are also housed at Chawton House. These volumes belong to various female members of the family, as it was the custom from the mid-1750s onwards for ladies to learn a musical instrument, not just as a pastime, but as an attribute in which to improve marital prospects. 6 of the books belong to Jane Austen, and 2 are signed by her sister Cassandra. The wives of Jane's brother Henry signed 4 books, 2 of which belong to his first wife, Elizabeth, and the other 2 belong to his second wife, Eleanor. A further 2 books are signed by Elizabeth Bridges, who was Jane Austen's other brother Edward's wife. I hope you got that. 1 book has the signature of Anne Cooper, who is a family friend. But there are 2 more books whose ownership have yet to be identified. To date, there are 10 printed music books, 5 manuscript books, and 2 which combine printed and manuscript music. I have compiled a performance catalogue as one of the volumes to my thesis, which lists all the pieces in the collection and composed order. Now, I'm assuming that unless you have brilliant glasses, you may not be able to read that, but I wanted to just give you an idea of the sort of the spreadsheet and the epicness of it. But this is a further breakdown of what's actually in the performance catalogue. Using this information, it is now possible to search composer entries for the first time. There are 548 entries altogether in the books. 270 are printed and 278 are manuscript. Several generations of Austen women copied and collected music during this time of rapid change in instrument building. As you will see, we will be using a variety of different instruments for the programme this evening, starting with the Broadwood fortepiano, built in 1796. The Austen family knew a range of keyboard instruments. Family members would have played the harpsichord as well as the new piano, which they would have known in various guises, from the square pianos that Jane Austen apparently owned to the grand pianos owned by wealthy family members and acquaintances. Though none of the instruments on stage are exactly what the Austens would have had, they give an idea of the range of keyboard types common in Jane Austen's lifetime. In the final pieces of tonight's programme, I'll be finished by performing on modern Steinway to illustrate how the repertoire from the Austen Music Collection works just as well on non-period instruments, which is an area that I wish to pursue after the piece's completion. So the duet that we're about to play was a particular favourite in the Austen family and belonged to Jane. She most likely played the duet with her sister or niece. I have screened an extract of the solo version for you to observe the neatness of the music copying. The overture itself was written in 1760 and was particularly popular as an example of Italian comic opera for several decades. There are further details about the pieces in the programme notes, and I've also included citations from some of the slides and words and translations to the songs. So here is the first piece.
Thank you.
actions, trends, and individual choice. The music ranges from solo piano music, duets, songs from operas, and harp music. There are many songs from the theatres, with composers ranging from Dibdin and Shields to Storrs and Hook. There are many 18th century favourites, including the famous Battle of Prague by Kurzweil, some nursery rhymes, Scottish songs and French songs from Parisian music subscriptions. Out of all the compositions in the collection, there are only two composers who have over 20 individual entries. These belong to Handel and the theatre songwriter James Hook. Handel's music became even more fashionable as a result of the Handel commemoration in 1784, where a reported 525 players performed Handel's Messiah in Westminster Abbey. But the love of his music obviously spanned many generations. It is also perhaps no surprise that the Austen collection also contains so many theatrical numbers written by Hook, and amongst others, as Jane was an avid theatregoer. We are now going to perform two songs from the collection, an aria from Handel's Judas Maccabeus, which was performed at least seven times in Winchester during Jane Austen's lifetime. The second song is a theatrical song, written by the famous 18th century dramatist Charles Dibdin, who, as you'll see from the programme notes, falsely claimed he went to Winchester College. I have also included in the programme a description of Winchester written by Dibdin, following his travels around Britain in 1802. So perhaps this song is a reflection of his Hampshire country experiences.
Thank you. Thank you.
books, which belong to the Jane Austen Trust, but it's not until when my PhD started in 2008 that the other books have been loaned for viewing and studying. With the help of Ginny's books and my research, it has been possible to identify these three missing songs. This slide contains some of the memoirs of Jane's niece Caroline, discussing Jane's favourite songs, and a more complete version is included in the article. The first song by Robert Burns is in manuscript form. In the version of the song that Jane Austen knew, there have been alterations to the text. For example, the words Jean have been changed to Jane, which is one of many charming alterations. The original score contains the vocal line between the two staves, implying that the piece would have been sung and played by a solo performer. You don't want to hear me sing. The second song, by Michael Kelly, is an account of a marital quarrel. And this song is the first of two songs. I have included the words of both songs in the programme notes so you get a bit of an idea of the two songs. The second song we won't sing tonight, but is entitled The Husband's Return, and is where the husband gives his reasons for his infidelity to his long-suffering wife. And the final song belonged to Eliza de Faillite, who is Jane Austen's rather colourful cousin, who married the Comte de Faillite and was forced to flee from France during the Revolution. Her husband didn't make such a lucky escape and was beheaded. And so Eliza later married Jane Austen's brother Henry. During her time in France, she signed up to the monthly Parisian music subscription, from which this fateful song about two solid swallows is taken.
There goes, oh sweet myrtle, let fall
listed in the Hampshire Chronicle from 1770 to 1820 in the lifetime of Jane Austen. Again, unless you have really good glasses, that's the sort of highlight of what's in the appendix. After studying the newspaper advertisements, I noticed certain parallels in repertoire between the Austen collection and the concerts in Winchester, in particular the Hampshire Music Meeting. The Hampshire Music Meeting was a three-day music festival, traditionally held in Winchester at the end of September, early October. The first reported festival was in 1761, after which a tradition was established that Handel's oratorios dominated the festival, in particular performances of the Messiah. The festival was traditionally run by the organist and the lay vicars of the cathedral, and players were drafted in from the region to swell orchestral numbers. One such player was the performer and composer John Marsh, whose meticulously kept journals have been carefully edited and indexed. John Marsh was a freelance violinist and composer, in addition to organising the prolific concert series in Chichester. The journals are a fascinating insight into 18th century concert life in Hampshire, and uncommonly for this period, he lists performers, concerts and works performed on an almost daily basis. The stamina of the man is really quite astonishing as he gallivants around the southern counties on horseback. So this quote is taken from his journals in 1790. The Winchester Annual Music Meeting, being fixed for Wednesday the 22nd and the two following days, I thought, as I have now a horse in the stable, I might as well take a ride over and partake of it to see the two boys. This is Chichester to win this horse, I'm just letting you know. So, accordingly, on the 21st, I rode there, and after dining at Wickham, bumped it over the hills between Waltham and Winton, before I reached which, I was so tired of my long solitary ride that I began to feel happy at being arrived at near the end of it, and to anticipate the pleasure of a dish of tea at the George, with a lounge afterwards at the evening's rehearsal, and the amends I should receive for my journey in the three succeeding days of pleasure. On arriving, however, at the inn, I met with a sad damper to my spirits, as I was speaking a good stall for my horse during the 3 days of the music meeting, I found it was postponed for 3 weeks on account of the death of the Duke of Cumberland, of which notices had been put and sent to Waltham and Wickham, etc., which it was a wonder I had not seen. Instead, therefore, of my three anticipated days of pleasure, I have now the idea of trotting back to Chichester on the following day. On my return home the next evening, I was finally laughed at by the ladies, who heard from Mr. Toghills a few hours later, after I had set off, that the music meeting was put off. So the next piece is written by John Marsh. I'm sure you know horses were harmed during this picture. And the fact that the piece is contained within the music collection is of particular interest. How did Jane Austen come to know of it? In 1796, Jane writes of practicing for her piano lessons with George Chart. George Chart, as cathedral organist, took over concert organisation in 1797 and was a good friend of Marsh, as they often had meals together when he played in the orchestra. This is perhaps the link between Marsh's piece and its inclusion in the Austen collection. As a regular player in the orchestra, Marsh was all too familiar with the popularity of Messiah, and his links to the Hampshire Music Network enabled the piece to be circulated widely. It was originally written to be played on either the organ or the harpsichord, so Nick and I will perform this piece on the harpsichord.
Thank you.
and Jane's nephews both attended the college, so she would have been aware of some of the traditions of college life. With this in mind, it is interesting that the favourite Herr Dulce Domum with variations is included in the Austen music collection. As the composer Fisher was an oboist, the variations were adapted, presumably from an ensemble work for the piano by Johann Baptist Cramer. Fisher's connection to Cramer could have occurred whilst being led in the orchestra at the Hampshire Music Meeting by Cramer's father, Wilhelm, and his brother, Franz Cramer, as both Fisher and Cramer are listed as performing together between 1783 and 1786. This air and variations are very close to the original melody composed by Redding. There are also further versions written by the cathedral organist Peter Fussell, who was George Child's predecessor, and a version completed by Child himself at this time, all of which shows the knitted links between music, musicians, and the concert scene in London, linking to the provincial scene in Winchester. We'll show the various versions of Dulce Domum so you can compare the melody as it returns throughout its performance.
Thank you.
songs takes the music of Haydn as their theme. The first song, entitled William, was adapted by Thomas Billington from Haydn's Sonata in C major. And the following two songs are taken from the set of canzonettas that Haydn wrote during his second visit to England in 1794. Haydn had the backing of impresario Salomon, who did much to promote Haydn's career and compositions in England. Therefore, when George Child decided not to perform Handel's Messiah in 1800, and instead performed the recently premiered Haydn's creation in Winchester, it met with quite a stir. The 1800 concert is particularly poignant, as not only did the repertoire choice radically change, but I have come to the conclusion that it is very likely that Jane Austen came to see this concert, as she describes in her letters. And it is the Miss Morleys, instead of the second Miss Crook, who were the beauties at the music meeting. As George Chard had been teaching Jane the piano, the Austens would have been aware of the concert events that he was organising. The lead-up to the concert was described with great excitement by Marsh and the Hampshire Chronicle. And if we look at the handbill that was sent to subscribers, it lists a rather impressive lineup of musicians, including Salomon, who often led the orchestra in Winchester. The musician listing is very similar to that of the London premiere, where once again, Madame Mara was singing. We're perhaps starting to realise that the musicians' network was a very small world. The review from this concert is fascinating, as it is a very interesting glimpse into artistic trends at the beginning of the 19th century. The fact that Handel was favoured above Haydn is certainly reflected in the Austen collection, as there are 20 entries for Handel in comparison to 6 pieces by Haydn. The full concert review is in the programme notes, but here are some extracts for you to read whilst listening to the 3 Haydn songs.
You
mentioned that we'll come back to the influence of Cromwell on Jane Austen. This is largely because Cromwell was the only composer that Jane uses by name in her novels. We can perhaps assume that she showed a fondness for his piano compositions, or perhaps Cromwell was particularly favoured in the lead circles. Otherwise, why only mention Cromwell by name, and not some of the other composers we have heard from this evening? Through her acquaintances with George Card, she would have perhaps known Cromwell's brother and father, who often played in Winchester. It is also likely that Johann Baptist Cramer would have visited Winchester due to his adaptation of the Dulce et Decima that we have just heard. However, this charming sonata epitomises the style and clarity of Cramer's keyboard writing. The sonata is entitled Sonata for the Pianoforte, for which is introduced God Save the King. Variations and airs based upon God Save the King were very popular in the late 18th century, and there are seven examples of these within the Austen collection, perhaps signifying the patriotism seen through the Napoleonic Wars and political unrest in Europe. So we will hear God Save the King, rather amusingly, as the second subject in this sonata. But I'm going to move over to the Steinway, which obviously the touch and a lot of things are very different about it, so bear with me.
Thank you.
to fit into his life. As there isn't only a mere outline in the programme list, he escapes in castles and has scrapes with Marie Antoinette, leaves his father-in-law bankrupt. It all makes a rather eyebrow-raising read. So Dussek was often seen performing in Winchester, and in 1792 he married a 16-year-old, Miss Curry, who had gained fame initially as a singer, but later played the harp. In the 1792 programme, housed at the Hampshire Record Office, it is possible to see how she is described as Mrs. Dussek when she's playing the harp and the duet. So before we perform this final piece, I'd like to sincerely thank Helen and Nick for aiding me this evening. I very much hope you've enjoyed this musical journey through the Austen family music collection. But perhaps finally, the wise words of Miss Bennett should conclude this description.